every beekeeper should be able to recognize characteristics associated with healthy honeybee colonies. I travel all over the world, talk to beekeepers absolutely everywhere. They bring me in to talk about diseases, pests, nutritional stress, all sorts of conditions that happen to honeybee colonies. And I'm always pointing out the characteristics associated with sick colonies, but the beekeepers don't have a point of reference. They don't know how to compare sick colonies to healthy colonies. So I want to make a few statements before I get into this. Number one, I always tell beekeepers never, ever, ever start with just one colony. Because if you have one colony, you don't really know if it's doing what it should be doing throughout the year. Especially if you're a new beekeeper, you have nothing to which you can compare its activity, its behavior, etc. So I always recommend that you start with two or three or more colonies at the beginning so that you have some comparisons you can make when determining whether or not a given colony is healthy. The second quick caveat, or at least thing to mention before I get into what I look for when I go to hives, is that all of what I'm about to tell you is somewhat seasonally conditional. So for example, you might not expect to see brood in the hive in the winter or in fall, but you would expect to see it in spring and summer. So as I go through these external and internal cues associated with healthy honeybee colonies, I'm going to try to point out season dependency, and I'll emphasize throughout my discussion how important it is to link what you're seeing to what you would expect to see that time of year. So let's start with external cues. When I'm approaching that hive because I want to open it up and work the colony within it, I never just jump straight into that hive. I always do an external assessment, looking for some very key characteristics of those colonies to determine if they're healthy or not. The first thing that's usually immediately noticeable is the activity level at the nest entrance. Do I see bees coming and going with purpose? Of course, I wouldn't expect to see that on a cold day or on a rainy day, but on a warm day, certainly in spring or summer, I would expect to see good activity. And the way to know if this colony has good activity is to have multiple colonies to which you can compare. If no one's flying on today, well then maybe it's not a good flying day. But if this colony's not flying, but the other colonies are, then you have an indication that this one may be underperforming. So what would I expect to see outside of the colder months? I would expect to see bees coming in with pollen. I would expect to see a lot of activity during nectar flow, when I physically see flowers blooming, when I see bees on those blooms, then I expect every colony in my apiary to have significant activity. The next thing I look for when I'm approaching the nest from the external cue perspective is I look for evidence of dead bees. Do I see dead bees at the hive entrance? Do I see them on the landing board of the nest? I look at the base of the hive on the ground. Am I seeing dead bees pile up? Why do I look for dead bees? There's a cohort of bees in the nest whose job it is to take dead bees and fly them away from the nest. We call these undertaker bees. So in a healthy colony situation, you will not have an accumulation of dead bees on the nest entrance or on the ground immediately outside the nest. Now I want to throw in a quick disclaimer here. There will always be a few dead bees outside the nest, but there should never be piles, dozens and dozens, and certainly not hundreds and hundreds of dead bees at the nest entrance or on the ground. So flight, dead bees at the nest entrance. The next external cue is smell. Some of the things that happen to nests, especially colonies living in them, can create these rancid or off odors that you will recognize as you approach the nest. So, does it smell? Also, am I seeing evidence of robbing behavior? How can I spot that in a living colony? Well, when bees are robbing, there is usually defensive behavior being exhibited at the nest entrance. Bees are fighting one another. The bees from that nest or hive are trying to keep out bees from the other nest or hive in the surrounding area. So you'll see bees stinging one another, grabbing one another, biting, pinching, pulling, etc. Another cue of robbing is that bees will be trying to enter the nest in areas that aren't the entrance. Maybe where you put two boxes together, they're trying to go through the seams or the corner of the box or underneath the lid of the hive. Maybe they're trying to get through the feeder opening in the top of the lid. So I look for robbing behavior. Next, I look for debris. Do I see piles of debris piling up on the bottom board of the nest? Do I see it piling up outside the nest? Am I seeing the bees abort copious amounts of brood? Do I see chalk brood mummy? Do I see things like ants marching into the nest? Do I see damaged woodenware? Maybe the hive has been damaged in some way and I need to be concerned about what may be happening to the bees within. So all of these are external cues that I can pick up on to tell me a little bit about that colony in the nest I'm about to work. Now I'm going to move from external cues to internal cues. I've smoked that hive, I've used my hive tool to remove the lid. What are some things that I'm looking for? Well, in a healthy colony, when I remove the lid, I should see bees blanketing about 80% or more of the frames in the uppermost box. If I don't, maybe there are too many boxes or supers on that hive. But in a healthy colony, I'll see bees blanketing about 80% of those frames. So the adult bee population should be strong enough to occupy 80% or more of the combs in the nest. If I'm not seeing that, then I might think what might be happening in that nest. Another thing I'm looking for is the availability of food reserves. Now, maybe at the end of winter, I wouldn't expect to see a lot of food stores in the nest, but certainly during the main honey flow, during summer and in early fall, I'm expecting to see food reserves that are proportionate to the number of bees in the nest. So the way that I typically explain this is usually the area of the comb that bees use to store honey, I expect about 50% or more of it to have honey. Otherwise, they may be running out of food and I need to determine if they need additional food. So I'm looking for honey stores, but I'm also looking at pollen reserves. If I see bees coming in and out of the nest with pollen on their hind legs, are they storing it in the comb? Are they rearing lots of brood? That's an indication that they're bringing in and utilizing the pollen that's coming into the nest. So do they have the pollen stores? Do they have the honey stores relative to the time of year that they should have to keep that colony progressing? And again, I'll advocate one more time, you're wanting to match it to the season in which you would otherwise see it, but you also want multiple colonies so that you can compare multiple colonies at once to see if they're all exhibiting similar food storage behaviors. Now let's talk about brood. In spring, summer, and early fall, at least you should see brood in the nest. And that would be brood of all stages, eggs, larvae, pupae, and adults. So from an egg perspective, seeing eggs tells you that your colony has had a queen within at least the last 3 days. More on the queen later. The larvae will emerge from those eggs. And when I look at larvae, I'm looking for very specific characteristics. Larvae lie in the back of their cells in the shape of the letter C. So beekeepers often refer to these as C-shaped larvae. So they'll be in their cell in the shape of a letter C. When you look into those cells, you can see that pattern. The larvae should be pearly white and glistening. Larvae that aren't laying in the back of the cell in the shape of the letter C, that perhaps are twisted or discolored or are no longer glistening, maybe they're yellow or orange or brown, that's an indication of brood disease. When those larvae grow to fill the cell and are ready to begin pupating, bees will cap over those cells with wax. Those cappings usually are dome-shaped. They should contain no perforations because perforated cappings are a sign that there's a problem in the cell. And in addition to that, if you were to uncap those capped brood cells, you would see pupae of various stages developing. If they're white pupae, they should look like adult bees, just be white. Maybe they're transitioning to that stage with purple eyes. Maybe they're darkening, beginning to sclerotize, and their body hardened, and have hair and wings and all of this, and you would see appropriately formed, appropriately colored pupae through their developmental stages. Also, I like to look at the brood pattern of the brood in that nest. And so what is brood pattern? When a queen lays eggs, she's trying to lay eggs thoroughly throughout all of the cells in a particular comb. So if she's doing a good job of that, then brood in neighboring cells are somewhat related to each other chronologically, right? They're roughly the same age. So they would progress through their development at a steady pace. So when that frame is ultimately capped, when those larvae are ultimately capped and begin the pupation stage, you can look at that capped brood and see how many empty cells occur among that capped brood. So when beekeepers think about brood patterns, they typically think about solid patterns, moderately spotty patterns, or spotty patterns. When beekeepers use those terms, they're referring to what percentage, roughly, of the cells within the brood pattern actually contain brood. So, as an example, look at this particular pattern. We call this a solid pattern. That's because when you look at where the brood is, less than somewhere in the neighborhood of about 5% of the cells are empty. So 95% of the cells or more contain brood. In this next image, we'll see a moderately spotty pattern. Again, think about where the brood is. The brood doesn't have to cover the entire frame, but where there's brood, what percentage of those cells contain brood versus what percentage of those cells don't contain brood? And in a moderately spotty pattern, somewhere in the neighborhood of 60 to 90% of the cells will contain brood, but the other percent will be empty. When beekeepers think about spotty patterns, where the brood is, when you think about that area where the brood is, 50% or more of those cells will actually be empty. So the way that I think about it is I try to mentally draw a circle or an oval around the brood pattern and do a just rough visual estimate of what percentage of those cells are empty, and then I classify it as solid, moderately spotty, or spotty. And this really helps me have a good indication of the quality of the colony, the quality of the queen, the disease and pest presence in the nest. Let's talk briefly about queens. A healthy colony has a queen. You shouldn't necessarily have to go find her every time you go into that nest, but she should still be there, and you should look for indications that she's present. If you see her, that's great. Most of the time you won't, so you're simply looking for eggs. Evidence of eggs, evidence of queen. Also, evidence of queen would be the lack of supersedure cells. Supersedure cells are queen cells that bees are making to replace a queen that's poorly performing or produce a queen when you don't have one already. So supersedure cells usually indicate that there's something happening to that queen in the nest and the bees are trying to fix it. Now, supersedure cells can be mistaken for swarm cells. They're both queen cells. Swarm cells are developed strictly for the purpose of initiating swarms with that colony, whereas supersedure cells are initiated to replace a dead queen or to replace a queen that's failing. So do I see eggs? Do I see brood of the various stages of development? And do I see queen cells? All of these are indications to me about the status of the queen and the health of the bees therein. Let me talk briefly about diseases and pests. Every colony that you will work has something in it that is either a disease or a pest. I'm not going to tell you need to have disease and pest-free bees. It's not possible. In North America, as an example, nearly every colony has varroa. Nearly every colony has some sort of virus. In the southeastern United States, where I live and work, most colonies have small hive beetles. A lot have nosema. So you're not looking for the absence of diseases and pests. You're really looking for other cues that the bees are handling it well. Think back to brood. Are you having spotty brood patterns? Do you see shrunken, misshapen larvae? Do you see sunken cappings? Do you see perforated cappings? When you look at the adult bees, are their wings tattered? Are they twisted or are they full like they should be? All of these signs are signs of disease in that hive. The absence of these signs means that your bees are doing a really good job keeping those things in check. You can't worry if you see a varroa or a small hive beetle. Those aren't necessarily indications of problems. You really want to make sure that those pests or pathogens aren't causing downstream effects on bee and brood populations. The last thing I'll point out is a little bit more subjective, admittedly, but you can often tell the status of a queen in a colony just by the sound. Queenless colonies have this very characteristic roar that they do when you are working their colonies. It's almost a sound of queenlessness. 9 times out of 10, when I hear that roar, I'm able to identify that colony as queenless successfully. Occasionally they'll have a queen, but usually it's an indication of a problem. It's difficult for new beekeepers to spot that sound. You'll have to get used to hearing it, but you'll figure it out over time. So a quick summary: am I seeing good flight outside the nest? Am I seeing dead bees outside the nest? Inside the nest, do the bees look the way that they should? Is my brood pattern good? Are my larvae good and C-shaped and plump and glistening and developing? Do they have ample food reserves? Are the diseases and pests in check? Is there evidence of a strong laying queen? All of these are things that I look for just in my routine management of honeybee colonies. And if you can learn to spot healthy colonies, then you'll be able to address the stress in colonies better, because you'll learn to know when colonies are stressed. A last comment: remember that colony condition is intimately linked to season of the year. You've got to know what colonies should be doing to be able to spot colonies that are drifting from that behavior, which is again why I always recommend starting with multiple colonies. It's unlikely that they will all be in the same state of illness or disrepair. So instead, having multiple colonies, someone's going to be doing what they should be doing, and then you can compare other colonies to it.